with a story this morning about a man named Ben Jacobs. The story is set in a nursing home. He's telling it to a chaplain. Ben's life started normally, and by the age of 25, however, he had made his first $1 million. He became very wealthy, very successful. However, his life was marked by greed, anger, cynicism, 3 marriages and 3 divorces, numerous sexual affairs, a life of misery, absolutely no love in his life whatsoever. And he wound up in this nursing home with no one who cared about him, no one who would come and see him. He had one daughter that was estranged from him because of his behavior. And so he asked to see the chaplain. And when the nurse handed the chaplain the message, she said, "Good luck." Ben really didn't believe in God, but for some reason he asked to see the chaplain. So they started out talking about philosophy and world religions. And he said, "Can you come back next week?" So he did. The chaplain met with him again next week. The week after that, and slowly but surely, the chaplain began to ask him, "Well, what do you think about Jesus?" And so they began to talk about Jesus and about the faith. And slowly but surely, he began to see a change in men. And by the end of the summer, when the chaplain's term was up and he was returning to school, Ben said, "I have become a Christian, and I've put my faith in Christ." And the chaplain could see the radiance shining forth from his face. 10 years later, that chaplain, his name was James Smith, received a letter from the daughter of Ben Jacobs. She said that Ben had died, but that he had written the letter to her, asking for forgiveness, apologizing for his life and behavior towards her. And she forgave him, and they had 10 years together as father and daughter. And she saw and realized that he was a Christian, and that he had put his faith in the one, the only one, who could shepherd his soul. I tell that story today because today we see the story of Jesus feeding the 5,000. We see the good shepherd at work. 5,000 men plus all the women and children that go with him, it might have been 20,000 people, chasing after Jesus. They had heard the stories about Jesus. They wanted to hear what he had to see, say. They wanted Jesus to heal perhaps their loved one who came with him, or a friend that they had pulled along. They were hoping for a shepherd. They had put their faith in the priests of the time, the Pharisees and the Sadducees, and that was a dull faith with no heart. It was rigid legalism. So they were looking for a shepherd. Someone who would speak the truth to them in love. Someone who would bring them hope in their lives that were difficult and hard. So there's 3 things that we can take from today's story. Number one, obviously, Jesus is the good shepherd. He is the one who can lead all people. Sheep need to be led. If you just turn them loose in a pasture, they'll eat the grass, but they won't be able to find the water unless they get lucky and stumble upon it. Because sheep, well, are kind of stupid. They're helpless. They're vulnerable to attack. Any predator can take them down. They need someone to guide them, to water, to care for them when they are ill, to protect them from harm. That's what Jesus does for us. He is the good shepherd. because of that, he saw those 5,000 men and all the women and children, those 20,000 some people, just in need of a shepherd. He didn't send them away. Oh, go find food in the towns and villages and whatnot. You know, if you make it, you know, there without passing out on the way. They've been there for hours. No. He provided for their needs. He was the one that could bring them hope. He's the one that could bring them truth. He's the one that could feed them both spiritually. Secondly, Jesus is the bread of life. He said it himself later in the Gospels after this story. He said, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me shall never be hungry. You will have eternal life. If you eat my flesh and drink my blood, you will have eternal life. A very unsettling statement. It was to them. Many of his disciples heard that and they left. It's a little unsettling for us to hear it now. We have to eat his flesh and drink his blood. What is that? Well, he was talking about communion. He was talking about where we are going to partake of it in just a few minutes, depending on how long the preacher goes. He said, this is my body given for you. As the Good Shepherd, he gave his life for us because he loves you. In our Eucharistic prayer this morning, we're going to say this. And here we offer and present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy, and living sacrifice unto thee, humbly beseeching thee that we and all others who shall be partakers of this holy communion may worthily receive the most precious body and blood of thy Son, Jesus Christ. Be filled with thy grace and heavenly benediction, and made one body with him, that he may dwell in us, and we in him. When we partake of this holy communion, we are taking in the body and blood of Christ. He becomes one with us, and we become one with him. Cranmer put it this way. Bought this book at a conference. I keep buying books at conferences and I never get to read them. But I was reading in this one and he said this. For as there is a carnal generation and a carnal feeding and nourishment, so is there also a spiritual generation and a spiritual feeding. And as every man by carnal generation, a father and mother, is carnally begotten and born unto this mortal life, so is every good Christian spiritually born by Christ unto eternal life. And as every man is carnally fed and nourished in his body by meat and drink, even so is every good Christian man spiritually fed and nourished in his soul by the flesh and blood of our Savior Christ. So here we have the words of Thomas Cranmer, who wrote most of our prayer, telling us that what we are about to do is real. We are receiving the body and blood of Christ. He is present spiritually in what we are partaking. And then the third thing that we need to remember from today's story is that Jesus cares. He didn't take care of just the disciples. Well, here's five loaves and a couple of fish. We'll divide it amongst the 12, and maybe we'll all each have enough to keep us until we can go get some more. He could have done that. He gave it away, and in doing so, multiplied it. He takes care of us spiritually and physically and emotionally in every way because he loves us. The disciples, they were clueless. They had no idea what he was about to do. He was testing them. Well, what are we going to feed them? They're like, are you out of your mind? We don't have enough money. We certainly don't have enough food. But Jesus loved the 20,000 people who were there, plus the entire world. He saw their need, and he wanted to meet it. In the same way, you and I are called to meet the needs of people in the world. You and I, we are called to love as Jesus loved, to care for the hungry, the lonely, the lost, the broken, the helpless, and the hopeless. All those people out there who need a shepherd, we are called to reach out with our hands of love to them. Now, obviously, one person can't do it all. I can't leave this place today and go feed all the hungry people in the world. I can't house all the homeless. I can't heal all the brokenhearted. But we know someone who can. His name is Jesus. And each one of us, being the hands and feet of Christ, can make a difference in the lives of people every single day. I say this over and over again to people. Well, what can I do? Every day you wake up in the morning, you have an opportunity to make a difference in someone's life. Just by being kind, by smiling to them, by giving them a compliment, by encouraging them, by loving them. Every person you run into, you can make a difference. I'm going to end with one more story. I've told this story before, but it bears repeating. A junior high boy named Bill was walking home one day. He was carrying a lot of stuff. He tripped and fell, dropped some things. Mark was walking behind him, and he saw him trip, and he came up and said, "Here, let me help you." And picked up some stuff. He said, "Hey, I'll help you carry it home." And Bill said, "Okay." So Mark and Bill went to Bill's house, and they stayed and played some video games, and had a good time. Mark went home, didn't think anything about it. They went on, they didn't become best friends, but they were friends and spent time together. They wound up graduating from junior high school and going on to high school together. They weren't super close, but they knew each other and spent some time together occasionally and graduated. The day of the graduation, Bill went up to Mark and said, "You know what? You made a difference in my life." Mark's like, "Well, how'd I do that? Remember the day we met when I tripped and fell and dropped all that stuff?" He said, "Yeah, I was wondering why you were carrying all that stuff." He said, "I cleaned out my locker at school. I was going home to end my life. I didn't think anybody cared about me. My girlfriend broke up with me. I didn't think my family cared about me. I was ready to end my life. And when you stopped to help me, you saved my life." We can make a difference every day. Let us pray. Lay not up for yourselves treasures upon earth where moth and rust